We're so honored tonight to have with us Apostle Louis Capdevilla. Let's give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah.
Love you, man.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Turn to that person next to you. Look right to the person behind you there. Oh, no. Yeah, that's right. That's not going to work. Shout with me. Let's see if you got shout me. Put your hands up and say with me, I say to you, Papa, to you, Jesus, and to you, Holy Ghost, 999,000 Googleplexes of hallelujahs, thank yous, and we love yous, times 999,000 zentrillions, Googles, septillions, sextillions, trillions, billions, millions, thousands, hundreds, tens, fives, ones of hallelujahs. Thank you. And we love you, Papa. We love you, Jesus. And we love you, Holy Ghost. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. This one now, we're going to turn around and get somebody in front of you. Come on, two or three people, groups of two or three people. Everybody, groups of two or three people. There you go, guys. And say with me, by the stripes of Jesus and his shed blood, I'm wealthy and healthy, wise and rich. I am righteous and holy and just. I am loving, joyful, peaceful, and patient. I declare that I'm the head and not the tail. I'm from above and not beneath. I'm the lender and not the borrower. I freely receive in every area of my life what you so freely given me through Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Give the Lord a hand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Everybody had a good month? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles with you, I want you to go with me to Luke chapter 17. As I promised, when I said when I come back, we would touch this subject that nobody wants to talk about, but I believe it is very key to what's happening worldwide and to what may happen in just a short time. The Bible says in Luke chapter 17, verse 26, but as in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat and drank, and they married wives, and they were given in marriage unto the day that Noah entered the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. Likewise, also, as it was in the days of Lot, they did eat and drank and bought and they sold and they planted and they built. But the same day that Lot went out of Sodom and rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even thus it shall be in the days when the Son of Man is revealed. We've been on the last two or three months talking about as in the days of Noah. And we discovered a bunch of things, didn't we, that were very interesting. Go with me, if you would, to Genesis chapter 6. Genesis chapter 6, verse 1. Be patient with me as I develop this. The Bible says in Genesis 6:1, and it came to pass when man began to multiply on the face of the earth, that the daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of man, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. Now, if you read this whole chapter in contents, in verse 13, it says, God said to Noah. So we're in the days of Noah. Verse 3 says, and the Lord says, my spirit will not always strive with man, for that he is also flesh, yet his days shall be number 120 years. Verse 4, there was giants in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God went into the daughters of man, they bare children to them, and the same became mighty men, or they became gigantes, or giants, which were of old men of renown. So we saw that there was a phenomenon that happened during the times of Noah. Not only were people kind of distracted in living life, but they also got into this very violent mode. But a very interesting thing that the church very seldom talked about was the visitation of the fallen angels. That they left their habitat that God had given them, and they came down to have relationship with the daughters of men. And we proved that in the last two times that I was here. And out of that came a giant race. And we showed you those pictures last time that I was here, and we saw that these giants were anywhere from 9 feet tall to 39. The biggest giant that they have found around the world right now is about 39 feet. Think about that. Now we know how they build the pyramids. But the intention of the devil to bring and have relationships with the daughters of men was to pollute the bloodline so that man would multiply with that polluted blood, and the plan of the devil was to pollute the whole blood of humanity so that what God had promised humanity in Genesis 3:15, that he would give the seed of the woman to destroy the devil, therefore the Messiah would not have entry into this world. That was his intention, to pollute the bloodline so that Messiah could not arrive. Correct? And we talked about that. Now we got to deal with modern time. Because modern times, we just read in Luke 17, Matthew 24, Mark 13, as in the days of Noah, so it shall be in the times of the coming of the Son of Man, of the Son of God, Jesus Christ. And all of a sudden, we talked about it last time a little bit, and I promised that I was going to expand on it. We're starting to have supernatural manifestations of fallen angels, which the church has not wanted to confront this issue, because the church, now it's when it's starting to talk about UFO and aliens and abductions and so forth, but the church has not wanted to deal with it because they had no explanation. My first book, but I wrote a book back in 1992 called The Antichrist is Coming Via UFO, and It was not very popular. It was not well accepted because nobody wanted to talk about it. And because I'm a seer, the Lord allows me to see things years before they come to pass. All right? I got laughed at, persecuted. I'm a conference speaker. I would put all my books out there, and this book they never let me put out until recently. Because now you got the Travel Channel, the Science Channel, the Smithsonian Channel. You got all different channels talking about aliens and UFOs. But the Bible says that man, 1 Corinthians 10:13, read it. Man cannot be tempted with nothing that is not common to him. In other words, if the whole world is being tempted with UFO, alien abductions, there has to be a biblical explanation. In other words, the devil can't introduce things to humanity that is not within God's perfect will or within the will of God. And I want to read a couple things that I quoted back in 1992, why this subject is so important. Michael Mann, a UFO researcher, echoed what so many experts have stated. The coming alien appearance on the world scene will be one of the most tremendous, perhaps shocking revelations in the history of mankind. For all intents and purposes, it will change everything we call knowledge. It will radically change history and affect all the world religions. Extraterrestrials are about to reveal their influence on the development of mankind. Their disclosures will shake the foundation of science, history, and religion. That is a come. The church needs to hear this message. Dr. John Kilmore from the University of Rosebridge said, in our lifetime, we will be obligated to rewrite the neutron philosophy of biomedicine, physics, and history books. A scientific revolution awaits mankind because of what people without Christ don't understand, that these are beings from a far more advanced civilization, when in reality they're fallen angels getting ready to bring the greatest delusion that the world has ever seen. Go with me a minute, if you would. Go with me to 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians reads like this. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Verse 3. Let no man deceive you by any means. 2 Thessalonians 2:3. That the day shall not come except there be a great falling away first. That's happening right now. And that the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshiped, that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Verse 7. For the mystery of iniquity does already work. The mystery of iniquity is already at work, folks. We don't have to wait for the Antichrist to arrive. He's already working. Only he who now let it will let until he be taken away, taken out of the way. Verse 8. Then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Verse 9. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power, signs, and lying wonders. Let me repeat that. With all power, signs, and lying wonders. In other words, as we near the coming of the Antichrist, and in the case of my book, I wrote the Antichrist is coming via UFO. In this book, I wrote it as a theory, not a doctrine, a theory, because I believe this is what's going to bring this great delusion upon the face of the earth. Notice what it continues to say there in that very same chapter. It says like this, verse 10. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they may be saved. For this cause God shall send them strong delusion, that they shall believe a lie, that they all might be damned, who believe not in the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. But we are bound to give thanks to God. Now, this is the thought here. Man is always looking for a way not having to repent. Man is always looking for a way to excuse his behavior or having to subject himself to a God that demands righteousness. So therefore, if you have these beings saying that they're from another world and there's no such thing as sin, the unrighteous man celebrates. Because deep in his heart, he does not love the truth. You know why most people don't want to read the Bible? Because they know that the Bible speaks truth. But that same truth that sets us free is this very same truth that will harden your heart. And I'll get back to that in a minute. Let me tell you a testimony. I was about 9 years old. That's a long time ago. 50 years to be exact. I know my gray hairs give me away, but I'm really very young at heart. For some particular reason, this particular night, which I believe was a Friday night, because I believe that I didn't go to school the next day, I decided that I was going to sleep with my grandmother. All right, my grandmother lived in the house with four boys and my mom and dad. She had her own room, and that night, for some strange reason, I decided that I was going to sleep with my grandmother. In the middle of the night, I hear this tapping on the window. Her bed was backed up into these 6-foot windows, and I hear something going like this. And for some reason, I woke up and I got up and I can remember several things. It was a full moon outside because it was bright outside. And what I saw at the age of 9 is what today we call grays, or I don't know if you know anything about aliens or whatever, what we call gray aliens. They're the one with the funny head and the eyes like that. And I know that I wasn't dreaming, because as soon as I saw him and I looked straight into his eyes, he looked straight at me, I saw the hand in which he was tapping, these funny fingers. I decided that it was time to get under the cover. And I did. But I never went back. I got so scared and so spooked that I didn't fall asleep the rest of the night. That's how come I know that it wasn't a dream. After that night, the closest thing that I got to something like that was Star Trek. How many of you grew up watching Star Trek? But you see, Star Trek makes these beings very friendly, or most of them. They become very approachable. They become interactive with human beings. And I want to caution you. This is very serious. I want to caution you. Because today I'm bringing revelation of this thing. And if you go on the internet, you would be there for years looking at videos, reading articles. I mean, there's so much in this. But the problem with that is when you're dealing with aliens and UFOs and all this stuff, you're dealing with manifestations of demons. And you can't do that. And you can be sucked in to try to want more and more of this mystery and watch more of this revelation and get, you know, closer to what may be the actual truth, that it will suck you in. Now, for years, I'm a Ghostbuster. For years, I've been casting out devils. I know that a nice guy like me don't look like I cast out devils, but you walk with me and you'll see that I cast out devils all the time. Spiritually and sometimes physically. Because if in my restaurant you talk about America, I'll kick you out. Because I'm grateful as an immigrant to be part of America. But as Americans, we need borders because we can't become a land of lawlessness. But I'm not going to get into that. And throughout the years of, I mean, I remember when I first started casting out devils that I would have to fast 2 or 3 days because there was this person that was going through some stuff and, you know, we had to have the oil and the, you know, we had everything had to be right. And then we would go in there. And sometimes we would spend about a whole day, 2 days trying to cast that thing out of people. Today, all I got to do is, in the name of Jesus, come out, boom. Because I know my authority. It's not about me. It's about what Jesus Christ accomplished on the cross. But throughout the years, I have known ministers that got curious. And as they were casting out devils, they start talking to devils. Big mistake. Because those devils are very seducing. And they know your weaknesses. You know how come the devil knows your weakness? Because just like you were given a guardian angel, there's also a demon that follows you all the days of your life. It's called a familiar spirit. That's a kind when somebody dies and their family gets together for a seance, a psychic could tell them everything about their lives because there's a demon feeding them that information. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And I have seen ministers and ministries destroyed by that curiosity. You've heard of curiosity killed the cat. And this is something that we must be very careful. Even though I've been preaching about this for years, I could almost tell you that I treat the subject at arm's length. Because we're dealing with actual manifestations of devils and demons. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Amen. And this is the last frontier. Because right now, most of humanity wouldn't know the devil even if he was sitting right next to them. But the truth is, there's coming a time where this big delusion is coming and humanity will accept these manifestations of these devils, aliens, call them what you want. Just the same way as in the days of Adam, the Son of God had relationship with the daughters of men and they were accepted and there was interchange and interrelationship among them and it became very, very natural. Very common. Because the day that the mystery is revealed, because right now, even after all people, thousands, you go in the internet and you Google people that have been abducted, thousands upon thousands upon thousands upon thousands have been abducted, but yet it remains a mystery. But once the mystery is taken out, and like these guys said in the book, that they reveal themselves, imagining these UFO finally coming out in the open, and all over the world, they come to major cities, and people will be mesmerized by them. And when they promise them, when they promise them a ride in one of those UFOs, they're going to be like a kid with a candy stick, because they're going to want to ride that fast vehicle. Oh, you don't got a job? Come with me. We got jobs in the other world. And they're going to offer, humans solutions to everything. But it's one big lie. It's one big lie, because we know the truth. We have the Bible. We know the will of God. It's amazing that the only thing that stops these aliens, and is you can Google it, is when people use the name of Jesus, everything stops immediately. Everything stops. The reason why is because they're not aliens. They're demons. They're devils. They're fallen angels. Now, the truth of the matter is the alien conspiracy has already become very deep, because already they're working with governments. So now already, I would be here a long time. Okay, I just came to tell you this, whether you believe me or not. I just came to tell you. The day you see it, the first person that's going to come to your mind is me. Because you're going to hear, I told you so. But that's exactly my intent. I'm here to inform you so that the day it happens, you've been warned. Already, governments are working with these aliens to the point that we have discovered their patent technology, where we are producing mass amounts of these UFOs for a coming day. Now, be patient. This is introduction. All right? Because I want to take you someplace, and in this subject, I could be here a whole year. But I'm not, because we're dealing with devils and demons, and we just need to mention it, tell you what the agenda is, and then keep going. So, back in 1988, I'm vice president of Casa de Joven. It's a church planning organization. We were planting churches all over Central South America. In the church in Miami, there was a man by the name of Feliberto Cardenat. You could Google him as well, and you'll find his name there and everything that happened to him. On a Saturday afternoon, him and his wife and his daughter are traveling south on U.S. 27. They're going to go kill a hog, because that's what Cubans do. We go kill hogs and then we roast it. There's nothing like a good hog. They turn into a dirt road, and his station wagon starts to sputter. He tells a story of he gets off the car, he puts up the hood, his wife and daughter are in the car. Suddenly he starts to see these spots in the hood, a humming noise, and all of a sudden he starts to be elevated. And he's taken higher and higher. By this time, his wife and daughter are outside the car and they're screaming. There was no cell phones back in those days. That's all they could do, scream. He is taken. Once they waited around for over an hour, they got back in the car and they went to a nearby 7-Eleven. They called the police. The police met them there. They followed them to the place that this happened. They took down the reports. And when it got dark, they said, "Lady, you got to get out of here because it's dark." So she left home. And for 3 days, nobody knew anything about Filiberto. Filiberto tells the story because I had him, me and Anita had him at our home for a week, and we interviewed them getting ready for this book, him and his wife and daughter, who was 12 at the time. And he tells a story that he arrives in this big, what he calls, he didn't have a name for it back then, a UFO, una nave. And how these creatures or these aliens communicated with him by the mind. Now that tells you something there. How does God communicate with you now? Through the spirit, right? Through the mind. How does devils and demons speak to us now? How many people have ever never heard of the voice of a demon or devil? Have never. Never. Oh, yeah, you have. You just didn't know it. It's that voice that tells you, look, this is better than that. You don't hear an audible voice, but you hear it in your mind, don't you? Isn't that the way it works? Because that's spirit. God is a spirit. Devils and demons and fallen angels are spirit. So they communicate through the same way. So he tells a story how they communicated with him and told him that they were going to put him in another smaller unidentified flying object. So they transported him. Then he tells the story how he says in a moment's time he believed he was in Peru because this unidentified flying object is coming down these mountains that look and there was llamas. You know llamas? And then it went into the water, and then the next thing he knows, he says that he's taken, they get off of this unidentified flying object, and he thinks he's in the middle of the earth because of the smell of sulfur. And he's brought before a man that told him that the reason that they brought him there was because at that time him and his wife were into the occult, and they were taking and revealing themselves to all these people in the occult because they were wanting them to know that there was a time in which he was going to make his appearance on the earth and control the world. 3 days later, he's brought back to the very spot he was taken. He walks to the 7-Eleven for about an hour. He had to walk there. He calls his wife. They call the police. They take him. They take him to a hospital. You can look it up on the internet. And they examine him. And one of the first characteristics was that he smelled like sulfur. He went on to be taken a total of 28 times and his wife 3 times together with him. So, as a preacher, I'm hearing this guy tell me the story. I had him tell me the story 20 times because I wanted to make sure he wasn't lying to me. Because if this guy's telling me the story after he became born again. He became born again because he said that these aliens tried to control the mind. It was a very oppressive spirit that would try to control the mind. And then he got this eerie feeling that this was not good. He happens to get born again. So now as a preacher, I've heard the story. I got to say, is this biblical or not? Because he can't be tempted with nothing that is not common. If my friend went with that happened to him and it's true, there has to be a biblical explanation of what has happened to him. Because the Bible says you cannot be tempted with nothing that is not common to man. And if people are being abducted by the thousands throughout the years, there has to be an explanation. Therefore, some people looked at me and say, come on, apostle, a city in the middle of the earth. Literally, they look in my eyes and say, come on, you really believe that? Have you lost your marbles believing that? So that's what inspired me to write this book, because I had to get that man experience and try to find scripture that would prove the possibility within God's will. Right? So let's just deal with a few of them here. I got to what, 12 o'clock? All right. I'm glad. Go with me to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 9. Ephesians 4, 9 says, talking about Jesus. Now he that ascended, what is it? But also he descended first to the lower parts of the earth. Where? He descended is the same that also ascended far above all heavens, that he may fill all things. Verse 10. Go with me to Philippians 2:10. Philippians 2:10. Philippians 2:10. What does it say? Philippians 2:10 says this. Philippians 2:10 says, it says, wherefore, verse 9, wherefore God has highly exalted him, given him a name which is above every name, verse 10, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow of things that are in heaven, things that are in the earth, and things that are where? Wow, right? Why would he say that? Because if you got the heaven and the earth, under the earth is nothing, right? Go with me to Revelations chapter 5. Revelations chapter 5, verse 3 says, Revelations 5:3 says, and no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. Now, let me put it in contents if you want to read real grammar. No man in heaven, no man nor on earth, or no man under the earth. If you want to break it up in grammar. Why would he say that? Revelations chapter 17. Revelations Revelation 17, 8. The beast that thou sawest was and is not shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. He's talking about the Antichrist. Isn't that what my friend said? That the guy told him that he was going to come out up to the earth and control the world? I don't think I'm so crazy. Because it starts to make sense. Go with me to Matthew chapter 12. You see, sometimes we read the Bible and we know the donkey story and we know the story of, you know, all these things, but we have no revelation of some of this stuff. You just, hey, listen, you say, well, but that's not in red. All right, I'll give you one in red. You know, red as in Jesus said it. Let me give you one in red. Matthew 12:40. Matthew 12:40. As Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be, where? 3 days and three nights, where? All those people that thought I was crazy need to repent. Because I'm not so crazy. Jesus said this. Jesus said this. Go with me a minute to Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16, 22. And it says, and it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried into the angel, into the angels, by the angels into Abraham's bosom, and the rich man died and was buried. In hell, he lifted up his eyes, being tormented, seeing Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water. Cool my tongue, for I am tormented in flames. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime received thy good things. Likewise, Lazarus evil things, but he now is comforted and thou art tormented. Besides all this, between us and you, there's a great what? Gulf fix. So there's something down there, folks. Every knee shall bow on heaven, earth, and underneath the earth. Where were the Old Testament saints before they ascended with Jesus to heaven? Where? Somewhere in the middle of the earth. And they weren't just laying down. See, we have this poor idea of how spirit people behave. Just because they died doesn't mean that they were just, well, let's sit here for 4,000 years until Jesus comes back. So for 4,000 years, the Old Testament saints sat? No. That's not the way it works. But yet, that's the idea we get. They lived there. Are you hearing what I'm saying? They lived there. And if they lived there, you could also know that Satan had his spot picked out. Go with me to Luke chapter 4. Let's talk a little bit of new technology here. I got to hurry up because now I'm going to fall behind. Let's talk about new technology here. Technology, see, the technology that these beings, see, I got to say this, okay. As a teacher, I like to teach all the different views. All right? It doesn't affect my salvation. Okay? So a part that I could teach 7 days creation, I could also teach you the gap theory. Anybody ever heard the gap theory? Gap theory is Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, could have been billions of years ago. In the beginning, God created. Right? And then from verse 2, the earth was void. Who created Atlantis? Who created some of these huge cities that today we find as ruins? See, the technology was there, but because Lucifer rebelled and took a third of the angels and a third of what I could only believe is civilization, all right, the earth was buried in judgment. And then God brings Adam and Eve again, and he tells them, go and replenish. Replenish? How are you going to replenish something? Replenish means go and do something that was done before. My point is that this dark knowledge of how angels move and operate, in a little bit, if y'all just be patient with me, I'm going to show you ancient pictures with UFOs on them. UFO is nothing new. Luke chapter 4, verse 5. And the devil taken him into a high mountain, and unto him, and shewed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. Man, if that is not high tech, two things there. He took him to a mountain. How did the devil took Jesus to a mountain? One. And two, he showed him the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. Looks pretty high def to me there. Doesn't it? All right, I'm just to let you know I'm not that crazy. I was crazy when I wrote the book, but I knew I was going to get it. But today I'm not that crazy because now people are starting to catch on. People are coming. But it doesn't matter. Look, if you're in here today and you don't believe me, it's all right. All I want you is to let it be in your mind. Because notice what it says here in the book. It says, a theory. I didn't write it as a book of doctrine. I wrote it as a theory. I said, look, there may exist this possibility. All I want for you to take from here today is that if it happens, you don't fall in the trap. If they appear, you heard my voice and you heard the explanation that this is satanic. This is not of God. And you will not give in to it. Because there's a great, great delusion. Let me say this to you real quick here. Let me tell you the characteristic. Let me tell you the great characteristic of the times that you and I are living in. Let me just read a few things here. Go with me a minute to Matthew 24. Matthew 24, verse 5. Matthew 24, verse 5 says, take heed that no man deceive you. Underline that. Because delusion, deceivement is going to be the characteristic of the end times in which we're living in. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and shall what? Deceive many. Matthew verse 9, I think it is, because I wrote it here without the verse, says, and many prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. Because iniquity shall abound and the love of many shall wax cold. And he that endures to the end shall be saved. Go with me a minute. Go with me a minute to Revelation chapter 20. Verse 7. Revelation 12. Let's go and read verse 3. Revelation 20. And when the 1,000 years are expired, Satan shall be loose out of his prison and shall go out to deceive the nations. You see, that's what Lucifer does. He deceives. He is governed by deceivement. Is that the verse or is it verse 7? What I did, I made a mistake when I wrote it up. Revelation 20 what? Revelation 20. 8. And he shall deceive the nations. He deceives what? The nations. Go with me to 2 Timothy. Come on, just a few more. 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Verse 13. And but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Go with me to 2 John chapter 2. 2 John, 2 John, not John, 2 John chapter 1. 2 John chapter 1 says, verse 7. 2 John 7 says, for many deceivers are entered into the earth, the world. Many deceivers have entered into the world who confesses not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. This is a deceiver and the Antichrist. Who is a deceiver? He that does not confess as Jesus coming in the flesh. Go with me to Titus. Titus, right before the book of Revelation. No, right before Hebrews. Titus, chapter 1, verse 10 says, for men, there are many unruly and vain talkers, deceivers, especially they of the circumcision. Folks, listen to me. We're living in the age of deceivement. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. Go with me a minute to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Just a few here. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Says, verse 13, for such are false prophets, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing for his ministers also to be transformed as ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. You and I, by the grace of God and the Spirit of God, are being fed truth. And as long as you follow that truth, you'll be fine. But we're talking in a time where there will be lying wonders. There will be things that are hard to believe, and surprising. Like hold on, what do I do with the paper? Here it is. Could you go up there? These are some of the phenomena that are starting to happen. I mean, there's so many things, I just don't have time. Put there where it says UFO and put floating cities. Have you heard about the floating cities being spotted all over the world? In clouds? You haven't seen that? All right. This was taken in China. Could you turn off these lights a little bit? They've been spotted in different parts of the world because what we're realizing that as we're coming close to the coming of Christ, the spirit is meeting the natural. Okay? Put there witnesses, UFO witnesses. All right? And there's a bunch of that. I just didn't want to, I got a lot of things. I didn't know how much time I was going to have. Look at these. These are all in clouds. I didn't bring it with me, but I think I showed it here maybe last year, the different trumpet sounds being heard around the world. Did I do it here? Amazing. Why? Because heaven is meeting earth. Years ago, I'm talking about 10 years ago, I told my wife, I see the actual clouds, they're lower to the earth. And the thunder, you could hear it closer. My wife says, what are you talking about? And I would share it with my friends. I said, look, I don't know how to explain this, but the clouds are closer to the earth. And when it thunders, it's very closer than it was before. I said this about 10 years ago. 3 years ago, science did a paper in a journal how the atmosphere has shifted and come closer to the earth. He said, well, what does that matter? What it matters is that the second coming of Christ is very close and heaven will meet earth. It's exciting times. Go ahead and put there the ancient images of UFOs on art and caves. There's a bunch of them there, so you might just, oh, that's not going to show. You can't show that bigger? No? I mean, all over ancient paintings. I should have done it individually, but again, go and push the other one. See if we all in different caves and in different paintings done hundreds of years ago, other thousands of years ago, you see UFOs. UFO is nothing new, folks. Nothing. But for the very first time, you see, back in Genesis 6, the devil was going to deceive, he was going to pollute the blood. He didn't succeed, Jesus was born. The Savior came into the earth, he became flesh. So now, as in the times of Noah, as in the days of Noah, shall it be in the coming of the Son of Man? He can't pollute no more. Even though he could pollute the mind, but now he's all about deceiving as many as he can. Put there the transhumanism, which is another thing that It's very big now. We're cloning all kinds of people. And we're mixing animals with humans. And we're doing all kinds. Now they're working on humans with part computers. It's nothing new, folks. There's nothing new upon the face of the earth. And we'll finish it with this. Put there the thousands of testimonies or witnesses' testimony. I think I put it under there. Yeah, there. Oh, thank you. Well, we can't see it. You go on the internet and you could Google a lot of this. Let me warn you that 85% of the stuff you find in YouTube and Google, they don't believe in Christ and they don't believe. They think they actually believe that these are people from other world. So don't get hooked watching this stuff because it becomes very dangerous when I tell you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You could watch Chuck Mizer, Tom Horn, Steve Quayle. These are guys that are Christians that could really teach you on this. But just get it and run. Because when we talk about aliens and UFO, we're talking about demonology. We're talking about spirits. We're talking about fallen angels. And they're real. I had a friend of mine. I don't know if I've told this story here. I'll tell it. I had a friend of mine that he would tell the story of, he always tell the devil, devil, you're under my feet. But he always say it in a mocking way. And folks, don't mock the devil. Don't do that. You don't play with these spiritual things. And he would always say, devil, you are underneath me. But he'd do it in a mocking way. So on Wednesday night, he gets out of church. And it was that part of town that it wasn't so great. And he says that at the corner of that street was the most beautiful girl he had ever seen in his life. He ends up in the hotel with her. They're in the bed naked. She's on top of him. And suddenly the voice of a man comes out of her and says, who's on top of who now? And disappears. I'm sorry for being vulgar. Can you raise that up? Jeez. See where I get in trouble, man? He was so shocked that he went to the pastor and repented and confessed and even testified. You don't play with things like this. I have this little video, but it's running late and it's... Everybody all right? Let me just show part of it. It's an old video, and it goes back. This is not modern testimony. Back in Area 51, where what we call was the beginning of the modern push for UFOs. When you hear the Secretary of Defense of the United States say that there's $2 trillion missing in the budget and they don't know where it's at, I can tell you where it's at. It's being invested in all this different type of technology because they're working with demons, devils. We have heard the rumors for many years, but we didn't dare believe that. Because nobody dared to say this from the Bible. At least a possibility. Let's go ahead and we'll watch this for a little bit. The video. Again, I picked this one. There's 500,000 of them. But again, you got to listen and be careful, because there are a lot of voices out there that they would worship these things if you allowed them. Pretty loud. Stop it there a minute. The YouTube that I showed a little bit that we couldn't read, it's called Witness Testimonies. These are credible professionals that give hundreds and hundreds of testimonies about UFOs and aliens. The problem with the internet, you get crazy guys like me saying some of the stuff, and people go, oh, look at this fat boy telling all that stuff. You know what I'm saying? People laugh at it. But when you get professional, people tend to listen a little bit more. Okay? So if you go to Witness Testimonies on YouTube, you'll find hundreds. Again, you be careful what you listen. Go ahead. Remember him? Gordon Cooper? Mercury and Jimmy? Oh, you guys are too young. These are astronauts.
The right stuff. But there is another side to Cooper's lifetime in aviation. One that for years he would only discuss with close friends, until now. It involves his personal encounters with UFOs. For him, it began in 1951 while flying in Europe for the U.S. Air Force. There, Cooper and other pilots witnessed an incident that has never been officially explained. A vast armada of UFOs flying in formation at extremely high altitudes. Recently, Yolanda Gaskin spoke with Gordon Cooper. In this exclusive interview, Colonel Cooper spoke for the first time on television about his encounters with UFOs.
I've read about this incident you had in 1951, and you said you saw literally hundreds of unidentifiable flying objects.
Yes, they were flying quite high. How high, we couldn't tell, because we couldn't get anywhere near their altitude. But they were either very large craft way up, or smaller craft still well above what we could get to.
For a day and a half, all of this happened. But then no one wanted to talk about it.
Well, we sent a report forward on it, and the answer that finally came back months later was they were probably high-flying seed pods, which didn't sound very logical.
There are always a lot of excuses. There's always the weather balloons. I've heard that one before. Oh, yeah. In 1951, you couldn't even get close to the things that were flying overhead. You or anyone else that was flying.
They were faster, higher.
6 years later, Cooper again encountered a UFO. This one definitely was not a weather balloon. While supervising flight testing at Edwards Air Force Base, his military camera crew actually filmed an unidentified saucer-shaped object landing near the site.
As they were sitting there filming, a little saucer came from, it was a saucer, came flying over their heads, put down three little landing gear and landed right out on the dry lake bed. And they picked up their cameras and started over toward it, filming as they went. And when they got in fairly close to it, it lifted up, put the gear back in the wheel wells, tipped up, and took off at a great rate of speed. And so they came into my office and told me what had happened, and I sent them over to develop the film. And then had to go through all the proper regulations of reporting this. And we wound up having to send the film forward to Washington in the base jet airplane. And I don't know whether anyone's ever seen it since.
Now, the vehicle that you just described, how similar was it to the very first sighting that you had back in 1951?
Quite similar. It was basically the same planned-form vehicle. They were a double saucer, lenticular. But if you're going to be going in and out of atmospheres like Earth or other places might have, you certainly need a little more aerodynamic type of vehicle. And the saucer has the capability of going through the air at tremendous rates of speed and handling the bow and trailing wave without making shock waves. So it can be very silent while traveling at big rates of speed through the atmosphere.
But sightings of UFOs weren't limited to the military. Cooper has commercial airline colleagues who've also seen UFOs.
Yes, a friend of mine who's a captain on a major airline, at night was flying along, noticed this, suddenly a big glow came off his left wing, and he looked out and this big saucer was sitting right off their wing, and so he turned slide toward it and it moved away, and turned back and it moved back in position, and turned to his co-pilot and said, do you see what I see? And he said, oh, God, yeah, I do. And it trailed along with him for quite a period of time, then tipped up and climbed very steeply away. Was on Jim McDevitt's Gemini 7 mission, where they saw this glint of something metallic off in the distance. And he reported, and nobody had it listed on the ground, so he tried getting a picture of it, but the sun, unfortunately, was glinting off of it so bright. All you got is just a glint. There was no detail on what it was, but never any further sighting at all on it.
Years later, Cooper approached the United Nations with a proposal for a committee that would explore the UFO phenomenon.
All right, now tell me about the letter to the UN.
Well, the letter to the UN was in conjunction with a meeting that I had with Kurt Waldheim and the Security Council of the UN to try to encourage the UN to establish a committee to start comparing notes and data and information and to really look into all of this from an unbiased, neutral point of view.
Here's a quote from your letter. I believe that these extraterrestrial vehicles and their crews are visiting this planet from other planets and are obviously a little more advanced than we are here on Earth. And are you saying that's exactly why governments have been trying to keep this information private, because of that obvious advancement?
Very possibly, right.
Nuclear physics.
Like it is. Four major conclusions. After 38 years of study and investigation. First, that the evidence is overwhelming that planet Earth is being visited by intelligently controlled extraterrestrial spacecraft. In other words, some, underline the sum 27 times, some UFOs are extraterrestrial spacecraft. Most are not. Most isotopes aren't fissionable either. I don't care about those. Second, the subject of flying saucers represents a kind of cosmic Watergate. By that, I mean that some few people in the governments of the United States, France, England, Canada, Germany, have undoubtedly known since July 1947, and I haven't talked about the second crash west of there, or how I got involved in this in the first place. A few people within the governments have known that the planet has been visited. You don't keep secrets by telling everybody. The need-to-know concept is paramount. Third, none of the arguments made against conclusions one and two by the debunkers of the world, including my University of Chicago classmate Carl Sagan, stand up under careful scrutiny. Their arguments sound very good until you check them against the evidence, and then they collapse. And finally, fourth, this is the biggest story of the millennium. Visits to planet Earth by alien spacecraft, successful cover-up of the best data, the bodies and the wreckage, for almost 49 years.
Why are you interested, and who are you to know so many things about that, and to look like as if you believe all this story? Means you believe it.
Well, okay. I spent 14 years in industry working on canceled government-sponsored research and development programs, nuclear airplanes, fission rockets, fusion nuclear rockets, nuclear power plants for space. I worked for major corporations, General Electric, Westinghouse, General Motors, TRW, Aerojet General. I have been, right from the start, interested in far-out technology, advanced technology, space travel, things like that. And I've worked on programs that, like, we operated nuclear rockets this big at a power level of 4,000 megawatts. We operated aircraft engines on nuclear power. And about 1961, at the University of California Library in Berkeley, huge library, I ran across a privately published version of Project Blue Book Special Report Number 14, the largest official scientific study ever done for the United States Air Force Project Blue Book. They had data on 3,200 sightings investigated by professional people spending full time, categorizations, quality evaluations, charts, tables, graphs, maps, 240 of them. I was in data heaven because data's my ballgame. I like taking lots of information, making sense out of it. These are two released. Okay. CIA.
You could be there a long time. This is an hour. It's interesting. How many of you know these are professionals? You could trust what they say, even though you don't agree with them. But there is this thing called alien agenda. And it's been very patient, okay? Been very patient because the reason it's been patient because it's being held off to when the Antichrist appears. Because the alien agenda, again, theory, if it appears at the same time that the Antichrist appears, the world will more easily accept the Antichrist and his agenda. That's a come, the mystery hasn't been uncovered, because if it would have been uncovered years ago, when the Antichrist appears, it wouldn't have the same shock power. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So that how come this mystery has remained undercover. I would be here a long time telling you how the Illuminatis, okay, and many secret societies are involved already with the alien agenda. They think that they're worshiping a Messiah when it's one big lie. And Jesus said, unless he cut the time short, even the very elect would be deceived. That's how powerful this delusion is. You don't play with this. I caution you, those that are going to go and look up on the internet, there's nothing wrong. You don't have to be fearful. You just got to be careful and watch what you listen. Because you start listening about people and, yeah, I was taken to Mars and, you know, they're real and I talked to them. Listen to me. You're dealing with demons. You're dealing with fallen angels. You're dealing with the most powerful forces. Maybe you didn't grow up and, see, I believed in God because, and I believed in the spirit world way before I came to Jesus. In my house, once a year, we would celebrate La Caridad de Cobre. Caridad de Cobre was a saint, a patron saint of Cuba. And we had cousins that were spiritualists. And after the party and all the prayers to the, you know, to the Virgin, whatever, a cousin of mine would go in a trance. And this guy, kid you not, would pick up a big couch with his finger. This is how strong this thing is. You don't play with this. You got to respect it. You got to be careful of it. My intention of wrapping this up was that you know of the possibility of what I'm saying, of this theory being true, that if it happens, don't fall for it. And you need to start talking to your family members about it. Why? Because they may be taken. They may fall into that trap. I know many of my family members that said, hey, if they appear, I'm going to write it out. That's demonic. And give 10 minutes for questions, and then I'm going to wrap up and pray. Any questions? Okay. Hold on. Let me get it on tape here.
Playing with the spirits, I just think about the authority that we have. We don't have the authority to take power over all that stuff. You know.
Yes, we do. It's already a known fact that the only thing that has stopped, these are testimonies. The only thing that has stopped abductions and things like that is when people shout out in the name of Jesus. Suddenly everything stops. But a lot of people don't know that. A lot of people don't have that authority. They don't know about the name of Jesus. Most of the people on the internet, They think that these are people from other planets and so forth. That's a come you got to be very careful. They testify that it exists, but the philosophy behind it is not according to biblical standards.
Pastor Louis, I thought the biggest one they had found was 15 feet. You said they found one that was 39 feet tall?
Giant, 39 feet.
Wow.
Yeah, we showed a picture of it last month, was it? It was huge. I mean, huge. Yeah, yeah. All right, over here. Quick. Hold on, that way we could catch it on tape. Hold on.
Is it
true? Yeah, that way we could catch it on tape. Yeah. There we go.
Is it true that the sound of the shofar, the demon does not like that sound?
Yep.
And also the cross?
Yep.
Keeping the demons away.
Yep.
I am doing this. For some reason, I've been putting my heart to make hundreds of these. And I'm making them now to give out to people that certain people are supposed to give. Each desk on this place is supposed to get one of these.
Amen. Yeah. You know, I've been doing this for a lot of years. There's a lot of things. There's a lot of things that demons and devils hate. They hate the cross. That's a come. The crosses in the Middle East are being turned off churches because the devil hates that. Anointing oil. When demons see anointing oil, they think that they are looking at the blood of Jesus. Holy water, they run from that because it's a sign of redemptive. What is baptism? You die with Christ and you resurrected with him. The shofar. Shofar, that's my Cuban. The shofar, all right. Banners. You know, there's a lot of different things that help you. The Bible says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principality, powers, and dominions in heavenly places. There's a lot of equipment. Go with me real quick. 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians, I'm going to hold that one there. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Says this, 2 Corinthians chapter 10:3 says, 2 Corinthians 10:3, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imagination, every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. The name of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the word of God. You release them through prayer. You release them through praise. You release it through preaching.
Yes, there are several scriptures posted as far as under the earth, things under the earth. What's the correlation between things under the earth and the UFOs that are in the heavenlies?
Okay, good question. Well, remember that before Lucifer got thrown down to the earth, he had a heavenly kingdom. Now, go with me to Ephesians 6 so we can answer that question. That's a very good question. All right, Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6 says this. Verse 12. Ephesians 6:12 says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So not only do they seek refuge under the earth, but there's what we call the second heaven. The first heaven is the one we see. The second heaven is where there's warfare, and the third heaven is where God is. That second heaven is where, remember, Daniel had prayed, and it took 21 days for his prayer to be answered because there was spiritual warfare. So the devil is called the prince of the power of the air. All right, so he still controls that second heaven. Okay, in the spirit, in the heavenly places. Okay, when we pray, you know, it's a combination. You have the Air Force and you have the Marines. It's kind of like that, okay? Satan's army is a very well-organized army. Okay? There's ranks. There's archangels. And there's all different ranks of angels. All right? All the way down to demons. Demons are not the same as wicked spirits. And wicked spirits are not the same things as fallen angels or archangels and so forth. So there's a rank of angels that would be a good subject to bring one day about angels. Anybody else? Okay. Here and here. Ladies first here.
I wanted to talk about what you said, don't mess around with demons. When I was growing up in the apostolic church, it was this guy, man in church that had a demon. The preacher was going to cast him out. And they told everybody, you know, stay in the sanctuary, hold your Bibles and pray and stuff. So most of us stayed in, but they cast out the demon. And later on that night, two people didn't stay in the sanctuary. And later on the night, the demons went in them. So they had to call the pastor and the evangelist to come pray to get the demons out of them.
Yeah, and the truth is, you know, devils respect authority, and they also disrespect this authority. So listen, you could be here right now, and the devil has no right to be here. But bring me cocaine or illegal substance and put it here, you just gave the devil right to be here. See what I'm saying? And you can stand here, cast him out, rebuke him, and he ain't going nowhere because he has the right to be there.
I wanted to ask you, what made you pursue this and get interested in this? What caught your attention to want to teach this?
Well, it started when I was a kid at 9 years old, for heaven's sake. I mean, I saw this thing, and I didn't know what it was, and I knew I wasn't dreaming. That's one. Number two, a calling. I have this calling, all right, to be able to pursue truth. All right, without the fear of man. I mean, when you write about things like this, you know, it's a calling. And God has always given me the ability to see. I don't have too many dreams. I'm able to see things with my eyes open. You know what I'm saying? So it's also a calling. I can't explain why I wrote a book back in 1992 when it wasn't popular, but I wrote it. And I had no other choice. See, when I gave my life to Jesus, as I was searching, I wanted to know. I had questions like, God, if you're God, why do children suffer? I wasn't afraid to ask those questions. Why this or why that? You know, I wanted truth.
You're talking about after people die. Can you elaborate a little bit more on where they're at in the middle of the earth or
good.
Dealing with each other?
Yes. All right, so hell, that's a good question. Hell has different compartments, or there's different degrees of hell, believe it or not, that the Bible call Sheol and hell and Hades and different things. A person that dies from this body, all right, his spirit is the real him, and he's thrown into one of those compartments of hell. In Revelation chapter 20, they shall receive a resurrection body, and then they shall be thrown into the lake of fire for eternity if their names are not found in the book of life. All right, so who you are today, this is what I tell people all the time. You never, 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 you will never cease to exist. You have no choice. You are eternal already. The only choice you got now is where you're going, heaven or hell, that clear. You're not going to cease to exist. You will live in one or two places, okay? And there are degrees. Just like the saints will have degrees of rewards, those that go to hell will have the degrees of judgment.
I've been caught up in the YouTube thing. And I've seen certain things about the Illuminati, like Beyonce and the high people are being possessed by demons. Is that true?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, right now. There's a movie that I don't recommend you watch, but I'm going to throw it out there anyhow. Tom Cruise, Nicole Kidman, Eyes Wide Shut. Here, there's another question here. All right, there is nudity in that movie. And I don't recommend for us to watch a lot of this stuff because it sticks in your mind. But it shows how even tonight, around the world, especially in those in high places. When I mean those in high places, you could be in Africa and you be the spiritual voodoo doctor and you're in a high place. See? Or you could be a judge, or you could be a politician, or you could be an actress. And right now, as we speak, throughout the world, there are people that meet to worship Satan, to sacrifice to Satan, all right? And because they believe if they, the same way that we believe as we yield to God, God uses us for his glory, they believe that the more they yield to Lucifer, the more power they have. That's a come. It's not a hidden story no more. In Hollywood, it is known that actors and singers, they go and they sell their souls out to the devil for success and wealth and riches.
Yes, I just want to talk because I had an experience happen. Well, my grandma was always a praying mother. Mm. She always had a holy oil, and I ain't never know what was the reason for it. As a young child, I never knew. My granddaddy came in the house, and I used to hear his cane tap on the ground, and he used to basically stay there. And my grandma told him, "We don't need you here. Them children's going to be all right. Don't worry about it. I'm doing it." She stayed up all night walking the hallway and putting that holy water.
Holy water, yep. That's very true. And you see, what happens is this. All right, while majority, there are ghosts, all right, and there are spirits, familiar spirits, that while your grandfather may be in heaven, and that familiar spirit was the one that was walking back and forth, okay, and trying to convince you that that was him. You know what I'm saying? That's, you know, we the devil uses everything he can to deceive. Okay, years ago at an event, I would rent these booths, and I would pass out tracts. It's something that we consider doing and pray for people. In this particular booth event, I asked him if I could bring my mic, my sound system. They said no. So I'm under a big tent, bigger than this sanctuary, and there's dozens and dozens of booths, and all of a sudden, I see that there were several people with sound system. I said, "Hey, how come you let them and you let me?" So my neighbor happened to have a sound system. I said, "Hey, could I borrow your sound system?" And I got on top of the table, and I said, "Listen up. I want to tell you my story." And I started to give my testimony. For about 5 minutes, all right, everybody was listening. Suddenly somebody in the back said, "Get him down." Another says, "Let him up," and a commotion came upon that place. Okay, and it was almost a riot broke up. When I stepped down, this big old guy came up to me and started talking to me in African tongues. And I grabbed a couple brothers' hands and we started praying. And when I said the blood of Jesus, this guy ran for his life. See, the spirit world is very, very real. Now we have Ghostbusters, and they have nothing to do with Christ. You know what I'm saying? They're experiencing, but, you know, they become familiar. They make TV reality shows out of them. But this, what I'm telling you, and the devil, you see, the devil can be nice as long as he's deceiving you. And that's what he wants. It's when you know the truth that he'll come against you hard. Anybody else? Okay. We got time. Go ahead. Where's the mic? Mic.
Pastor Louis.
Throw it out.
From your experiences and things that have, you know, that you have experienced, and you come to a point in your life where you realize you don't fit. No one wants to hear this. No one wants this. They want love. They want peace. They want easy salvation. But you find that as through your experiences and the things that are coming in your life, God is pushing you in that direction. But you're in positions where you have to stay in certain lines. From your advice, you give advice. How do you justify staying in certain lines?
Okay. Truth of the matter is, we all go through dispensations in different seasons where nobody understands it, and God does it on purpose, because that's when you get tight with God. Come on, yo. I'll be frank with you. Sometimes God speaks to you and says, I want you down there, but your pastor may not understand that because pastors want to gather. See, apostles, we want to push everybody out. All of you are missionaries. Get out of here. All right? Pastors, no. You're not going nowhere. All right? Sometimes pastors, by not understanding the calling, they make enemies of their children. Okay? Instead of making sons, sending them out. I've had many sons in the Lord. I said, you better not go. And they said, oh, you want to go? Go. And I let them out. A year later, they come back. All right, and, you know, they repent and so forth. Others go, and I send them out, and it was God. So, it's all individual. Out of experience is you got to deal with God, and you don't have to apologize for that. You got to be respectful. You got to honor. You know, you got to submit. But, you know, I don't know if you ever heard the story of what's that book called? It'll come to me in a minute. There's a book out that they found in the Vatican about the journalist or the newspaper guy that interviewed Joseph and Mary. Because, you know, Jesus became quite a celebrity. So when he died, there was historians that wanted to write books. And in this book, it writes that when he went to visit Joseph and Mary, Mary complained that during the early years, they would fight with Jesus. Because he had all these promises, but he said that him and Lazarus would spend many times in top of the roof, looking at the skies and at the skies and the stars, and years would go by, and Jesus wouldn't do nothing until 30 years old, and it was his time. And tell how his mother and father would literally get mad at him because he wouldn't move, because he wasn't supposed to move until God's timing. Somebody else, quick, come on. Here we go. All right, go ahead and say it again.
The last time you taught on this subject, I was hesitant to, you know, give this testimony. And because a lot of times when I have told people, I know how they think. They think, oh, she's a little crazy. You know how you. This happened many years ago, and Fred, my husband, worked out of town a lot, and he goes to Miami. And so when he came back, it was gone several weeks. And when he came back, I was sleeping perfectly well until he came home. And the minute he came home at night, I was tossing and turning. Something was bothering me. And I got up and I paced the floor and I prayed and I thought everything was okay, and I was praying in the spirit. I lay down on the couch, and on the couch suddenly something attacked me here, and there was nothing physically there, but it was trying to penetrate me. It was pushing in me. And I jumped up and I couldn't talk. And I said, in my head, I said, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And it let go. And so again, I prayed. I walked and I prayed. I was spooked. I was concerned. You know what I mean? I felt that. And so but I didn't go lay down again beside him. I went lay down on the couch again. This time I fell asleep and it tried to enter me through my mouth. It was pushing, forcing its way in my mouth. I was choking. And again, I had to, in my head, I kept saying, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And when I said Jesus again the third time, it let up. Yep. And when it let up, I didn't see anything then. I walked towards the bedroom for some reason. And when I looked towards my husband, I saw this silhouette of a body lift off of him. And when it lifted off of him, he jumped up out of the bed.
Wow.
Like that. And then the thing went right by me, which I believe was a demon.
It was?
The demon followed him home, and it was trying to possess me, trying to take me. And it walked right by me like it didn't even see me. And it went into the kitchen. And like you said, I didn't sleep the rest of the night. Yeah. I kept praying and praying, you know. And then I was hearing things and stuff and going outside and looking and stuff. Because I was concerned. And I don't tell everybody that. And I hesitated not even mentioning it the last time you were here.
Let me say this. It's very common. People around the world, they get into the state of mind that they feel like they're being choked or suffocated. And they can't speak and like that. And their mind, they called on Jesus and it's broken. It's very common. Anita and I, because we're ghostbusters, we're demon casters, we have to anoint our house often. Anita, when we start seeing shadows, we see these little doors, or by the entrance of the door, a lady with a black hat just puts her head in. All kinds of different things. We know it's time to anoint, okay, because it happens. All right, I'm among thousands of people every week. And things are bound to, you know, stick on. All right? I've gone to sleep, and in the middle of the night, I open my eyes, and there's these I could only describe them as guys in dark robes, and you know that they're not angels. You know? And they look at you, and you look at them, and you got a decision to make. What are you going to do? Oh, well, the weapons is the name of Jesus, and you start casting out. So, I mean, the thing here is, if the devil can convince you that he doesn't exist, that's the greatest deception. That's the greatest deception. If you think he don't exist, he got you.
I think one thing we need to remember tonight, though, is that there's more with us than there are with them.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
And also that the name of Jesus and the blood of Jesus, we are carriers of that.
That's right.
And also, I believe that in these end times, when there's famine, when there's killing, live or die, we're his anyway.
That's right.
So we have nothing to fear.
That's right.
And not only that, we have the power to multiply bread. We have the power to speak to a rock and it give fresh water. We have the power because the Holy Spirit lives in us. And this tonight was not to bring fear,
right,
but for us to be aware of what's coming.
Right.
And to help those who are going to be deceived.
Exactly. If you stay with this knowledge for yourself, it really doesn't, it's good, but you gotta, because listen, how many of your friends and families don't know about this? You need to tell them. Over here. You need to tell them because, all right, we're not to live in fear, like she said. We don't. I don't live in fear. I'll wake up, see the devil there. I'm not gonna, my wife says, don't turn on the light of the bathroom. I says, no, I'm not turning no light on. I'm not going to let him win over me. The light stays off. You know what I'm saying? It's right. Ain't going nowhere. He can't defeat me.
The light is in you.
Huh?
The light is in you.
Okay, just before we came here tonight, on Channel 2, there's a program I always like to watch, especially on Friday night with Herman. And he has a man and they go over the Bible extensively on certain subjects. Tonight, he was telling people be aware of certain churches or what they're speaking and what they're coming out, that these are false preachers and they're steering us wrong, that you got to watch where you go and what you're being taught and make sure you get into the right church that's teaching you the right things of the Lord.
You know, right now, one of the latest fashions in churches today is to mix Christianity with Islam. And there's many pastors are saying that the God of Islam is the same God of Christians. And that is a lie of the devil. You know, and there's much more to that. I mean, right now, when Jesus appeared to John and says, I hate the sins of the Nicolaitans, how you say it? Nickelodeons. It was these guys believed that you couldn't sin. There was nothing such as sin. And we're living in a society today that there's no such thing as sin. Okay? And the church is accepting that. Now, we say that we have been perfected in Christ. All right? We're adopted. Okay? But we know we were sinners. And we know that because we were sinners, now we're saved by grace. But to say that there's no such thing as sin,
All right, one more and we're going to finish. Is that it? Okay, stand with me, please. Hallelujah. Thank you for your patience. As we were worshiping tonight, Brother Ralph comes up to me and said, we're 15%, what was it?
We're 85% there.
We're 85% there. We got 15% to go. And I'm telling you, Brother Ralph, that's so prophetic. We're 85% of the way. We got this 15% to go. And because time is going by faster, this 15% is going to come out real quick. Let me say this to you, and we'll finish here. We got a few months of holding our breath. I believe if we pass the next to January, we might just get another seven-year cycle. But the truth is, there's a chance of all hell breaking loose in the next three, 4 months. Two months, 1 month. This is not the time to be messing around, folks. This is not the time to backslide. This is not the time to take on a new hobby. You know, this is not the time of say, you know what, I'm going to, no, this is not the time. These are very, very serious and dangerous times. We have all the authority. We have the name of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the word of God. We got all that, okay? But the Bible does say that the devil is going to make war with the saints. Okay? And we are at war. We are at war. If you're not taking a little time to pray, take a little time to pray every night, every morning. Just set aside. Just pray. Just pray. If today I never prayed again, I'll be saved. But the truth is, we're living in extraordinary times. God wants you to pray. Because he wants to use you. He wants to prepare you. He wants to work through you. There's a lot of things happening. Okay? That's another time. Thank you, Lord. Right where you're at, just raise your hands. Papa, we thank you, Lord, for the supernatural. You're the God of the supernatural. You're the God that invented the supernatural. You're the God that invented the technology of speed and light and UFO, whatever it is that makes it tick. You're the God of everything that's good. And it's only man that has perverted it. It's only fallen angels that have brought it about to try to deceive. Father God, as I've spoken these words, Lord God, I've spoken it for the purpose that when or if it happens, we know how to choose and make a decision and to teach those around us. I pray that we discuss this with our children, with our grandchildren, with our brothers and our family members, because those that will be caught by surprise will run the risk of being deceived and fall under that delusion of those lying wonders. I thank you, Papa, that this church is a mighty church. It's a church that moves in the cutting edge. It's a church that moves, Lord God, because it's hungry for you and for your ways and for your will. And you will use this church, Lord God, to lead in that 15%. To lead in the 15%. To lead, Lord God. I pray even now, Papa, that those that are not baptized in the fullness of the Spirit of God, that they get baptized, stay filled with the Holy Ghost. Father, your word says that these signs shall follow them that believe. They shall speak in tongues. They shall cast out devils. Everybody here can cast out devils. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall
they shall recover. If anything poison bites them, it should not hurt them. I thank you, Lord God, for the supernatural operating in our lives. I pray for this word. I pray for those that will rehear this word, those who are watching on television, or those who are watching, Lord God, through the social media, Lord God, that you will use this message to prepare them, for the moment is near. Even now, I thank you, Papa, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Have y'all been blessed? Amen. Thank you so much, Apostle. Amen. As we don't forget about the picture, folks. We're going to take a quick thing right after the service. Amen. You see why it's so important to be rooted and grounded in God. Amen. I thought of the scripture, my sheep hear my voice, and the voice of a stranger they will not follow. Amen. But you're only going to hear his voice if you're in constant relationship with him. Amen. Amen. So we just encourage you, go hard after God. Amen. 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 Have y'all been blessed? Amen. Hallelujah. We'll be back Sunday morning. Amen. Amen. Let's lift our hands up to the Lord. Father, we just thank you tonight for that word. Father God, we thank you that you show us things to come before they happen, Father God. And so we can go in, Father God, with your perspective. So, Father God, keep this word in our hearts and bring it back to our remembrance in time of need. Father, we thank you for it now in Jesus' name. Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or think, according to the power that works.